next guest is one of my first and favorite guests we've ever had on this show. She's an outspoken conservative. She's actually a co-host on The View. I'm hoping she can help us understand what is going on inside the Republican Party these days. Please give a round of applause for Meghan McCain.
Thunderdome.
I know, exactly.
All the way around. Thank you for having me back.
Oh, no, thank you for being back.
Yeah. And you know, I love this show. I think it's such an important show.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate it, and you're such an important guest for us and such an important part of the family, and you and I get a chance to talk offline so much. And, you know, the last time you were here, your dad was sick and my mom was sick, and now both your dad and my mom have gone to a better place. I have not talked about it publicly. I just can't do it. You've actually, I think, done a better job of sharing your experience. You know, what have you learned about grieving? And what have you learned since your father passed that you wish more Americans who all of us faces at some point knew?
Well, the first thing I have to say is that I'm surrounded with support. Everywhere I go, somebody has an anecdote they want to tell me about my dad.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
It's a gift to have that because he's always present in me, but he's clearly present still in a lot of other people's lives as well. So I try not to feel bad for myself because I just don't think, I think he would be terribly pissed if I walked around that way anyway.
Right.
But I've learned that grief is a very toxic, taboo subject. It makes people very uncomfortable. And I am almost 5 months out since he passed, and I am sad every single day.
Yeah.
And I don't think there's anything wrong with sharing that.
Right.
I have moments where I think that I just can't do anything anymore without him.
Mm.
And it's a weird place to be in so many different ways. As a daughter, I'm grieving and I'm sad. As an American, I hate this country without him in it.
Yeah.
And I know that sounds awful. I don't hate America, but I just hate it without his leadership.
You hate that vacuum.
Yeah. And I'm sad all the time. And I'm struggling with that sadness. And I miss him in ways that I never even could have fathomed. Mm. And then I try and say, what would my dad say? And he'd say, we are McCains, and we don't feel sorry for ourselves, and we're blessed, and get up and go keep fighting,
right.
Meghan.
Yeah.
So that's what I try and do every day.
Yeah.
And some days are better than others.
You're not the only person missing John McCain. This vacuum is so pronounced now because of this wall, the shutdown, all this sort of stuff. I'm hearing now that you're saying you're not really calling yourself a Republican anymore.
I call myself conservative. I mean, I'm still a member of the Republican Party and I still vote on the Republican ticket, but Republicanism is so tied up with being for Trump. But I'm also not a never Trumper. Trump didn't melt my brain. I can still see like the forest for the trees, and it didn't expunge all my conservative principles out of me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just trying, I think, like our friend S.E. Cupp, women like us are just trying to navigate this right now, because I understand Trump supporters. I understand why they voted for him. I also understand why people think that he's tearing this country apart and the end times are coming, which there was a blood red moon a few days ago, which apparently is a symbol of the end of the world. And I was like, well, it seems about right now. So I'm just trying to, honestly, I'm trying to survive in a lot of different ways and politically as well right now. And just, but I'm not a liberal.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it would be intellectually dishonest for me to go on TV and start espousing beliefs that I didn't believe in. Something will come out of this in one way or another. I just don't know if it's going to be the traditional Republican Party, because Trump changed it so much.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not what I recognize anymore. And it's character seems to be gone, which to me, when I grew up, conservatism and character, like my father was like really, really, I would say militant about character.
Yeah.
And now it seems like lying, well, it's okay. It's a little nebulous. Stealing, it's a little nebulous.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it just, I don't think those are American characteristics.
Mm-hmm.
And it scares me a lot.
Yeah. You know, this fight to keep, you know, our parties, good parties, has, you know, got a history. In the Republican Party back in the 50s and 60s, they had to band together, folks like you, and push out the Birchers. And then even in the 1990s, you know, Bob Dole had to take a hard stand.
Yeah.
In fact, I love this clip from Bob Dole. Play that clip from Republicans.
But if there's anyone who has mistakenly attached himself to our party in the belief that we are not open to citizens of every race and religion, then let me remind you, tonight this hall belongs to the party of Lincoln. And the exits, which are clearly marked, are for you to walk out of as I stand this ground without compromise.
I mean,
That's so good.
Yeah, that's so good. Yeah. Is it harder for your generation of kind of Abraham Lincoln Republicans to band together and boot folks out the way that Dole did, the way that the anti-birchers did? Is it harder for you now? And if so, why?
We're so outnumbered. Huh. I mean, Trumpism is the, I think it's 80% of Republicans support President Trump. And maybe they're doing it because they don't have another option. But I think the populist Trump brand really has taken over, which is why there's this sort of no man's land that I'm in, because I didn't become an ever-Trumper either. Mm-hmm. But that it's funny you play that clip, because it's actually one of my first like political memories was I was at that convention and I gave my first interview when I was 11. it's just a different time. I know. And then like Jack Kemp was his running mate, one of the great conservatives of our time. And it just doesn't really exist that much anymore. And by the way, this cynicism has come with Trump. I mean, I don't see a lot of leadership with people in office either. And there's some politicians that I thought would really be amazing at helping fight this fight. And they've terribly disappointed me.
This particular sticky widget around the wall is something I just want to get your thoughts about, because it gets very tense. I watch you guys on The View, because I feel like Trump took a tough conservative principle, which is border security. I have a different view of it, but I can respect a conservative who wants that. And he put it in the blender with a whole bunch of racist, crazy stuff and Steve King, and then he poured it out. And now you have to drink the whole thing or spit it all out. And, you know, so then Democrats get mad and say, listen, the wall is racist. And then I think, you know, you could hear that as we're saying all Republicans are racist. How do you make sense of our pain and our frustration? I mean, you really are in this kind of tough situation, aren't you?
Well, I will say I completely understand the other sides. I live in Manhattan, and I just have to leave my apartment, and I am inundated with Republicans are Nazis, they're the worst, everything you believe in is awful and ruining this country. Every moment of my life when I'm in this city, I feel it. And I think sometimes when I hear anyone who supports the wall is racist, it's a trigger for me, because I know people who are not racist who support the wall. But I feel like when we're living in a time when you have one or the other, people get very tribal. And I just wish my friends on the left, and I include the people I work with, would just see my side a little bit, just a little bit. See what it's like for somebody in Arizona who, you know, has seen the impact of maybe illegal immigration, or sees a liberal on TV talking about how great sanctuary cities are and thinks that's crazy as well. But it's hard for me, because I get very triggered as well, because I get very territorial over my people, if you will.
I've noticed that about you, and it seems to me that the idea of you being accused of being a racist is offensive even more than most people.
I think it's the worst thing you can call anyone.
Why do you feel that way? Were you raised that way? I mean, why?
Yes, and I come from, I think people maybe forget, I mean, I don't know the experience of a minority. I'm certainly not. I'm a privileged white woman that has a senator for a father. But my little sister is adopted, and there's a very famous political moment in 2000 when my father was running for president, when Karl Rove had a whisper campaign done that my father had an illegitimate black child who's my sister Bridget. So at a very young age, I had to sort of reconcile why would that even be a bad thing? Why does it matter that I have an adopted sister? I am not saying in any way this means
that
I have experience.
But I think it's important for people to understand that because you have a sister, you've had a certain set of experiences, and you've seen an impact of racism in your own life, that charge hits you harder than it might hit somebody else in a casual conversation.
It scares me, too, because I think it's the worst thing you could call anyone. I think it's hands down the worst thing you can call anyone, especially a public person, is that you're racist blank. And I also think it's thrown around too much, because if I'm racist, then what is Richard Spencer? Mm-hmm. And I think that there has to be delineations, which I know just like me saying that in particular might make people change the channel. Mm-hmm. But I think it's thrown out too often. But I will say that for me, of all the things that have ever been said or accused, it is the most deeply hurtful. I have taken it home to me at night. I'm just here to ask questions. I'm here to represent where I come from. I'm here to represent my party. I'm here to represent my family. And honestly, if people don't like it, these are rotating seat. You can replace me. It's like having a residency in Vegas. So, you know, you can have somebody else do it instead.
We want to keep you right where you are on The View and right here. We're going to come back.
For now, I'm still employed.
Exactly, which we like a lot.